So dear students, welcome you all for the module 5 of the heat exchanger lecture 4. Okay, I am Vijay V.S., assistant professor, department of mechanical engineering, CEC Mangaluru. The content which will be covered in this lecture is effectiveness of heat exchanger and effectiveness NTU relation for parallel and counterflow heat exchanger. So outcome is, at the end of this class you will be able to define what is effectiveness and derive the effectiveness NTU relation for and counterflow heat exchanger. Okay, now let us see why effectiveness NTU method is required. In the last class we have derived the LMTD expression for parallel and counterflow. Okay, now LMTD method is mainly used to find out size of a heat exchanger for the given temperature requirements. Okay, you can use LMTD method only when the temperatures of hot and fluids are known, that is both inlet and outlet temperature, and heat transfer rate is known. Okay, so LMTD requires at least 3 temperatures to find LMTD. Now, but most of the cases outlet temperature of hot and cold fluids are not known. Okay, inlet temperature can be easily found out, outlet temperature depends upon performance of the heat exchanger. So in such cases, so when outlet temperatures are not known, when only inlet temperatures are known, we cannot use LMTD methods. So therefore an effectiveness NTU method is used. Okay, yes, so the advantage of using effectiveness NTU method is it is possible to determine the performance of heat exchanger and check whether the available heat exchanger will do the job or not. Okay, so when you don't know the outlet temperature, when you know only inlet temperature, and if you know the size of a heat exchanger, okay, for approximate size, so for a given size how the heat exchanger performs can be easily find out, and also we can find out outlet temperature. Okay, so this was developed by Case and London in 1955. Yes, now let us go to effectiveness. What is effectiveness? Effectiveness is ratio of actual heat transfer to maximum possible heat transfer, that is given by Q by Q max. What is this Q? Q is already known, we have calculated in the previous classes. Q is given by MH CPH into TH1 minus TH2, that is also equal to MC CPC to TC2 minus TC1. Therefore Q is CH into TH1 minus TH2, and that is also equal to CC into TC2 minus TC1. This we already know. Okay, now what is Q max? This is a very important one. So Q max is given by C minimum into delta T max. For a maximum heat transfer in any given fluid, the temperature difference should be maximum. It means if it is a hot fluid should undergo maximum possible temperature drop. Okay, it should give away the maximum heat. And cold fluid means it should undergo maximum possible temperature absorption. So for hot or cold fluid, delta T should be maximum. But what should be the capacity rate? This cannot be maximum, okay, because capacity rate depends upon specific heat. So we already know specific heat means what. Specific heat is nothing but it is amount of heat required to raise the temperature of unit bath by unit degree centigrade, correct? If specific heat is more heat is required to cause a unit degree temperature difference, correct? So in this case the hot or cold fluid should undergo maximum possible temperature, that is possible only when its specific heat is minimum. Therefore with a small specific heat it should be able to undergo large temperature difference. Therefore capacity rate should be always minimum, not maximum. So therefore Q max is given by C minimum into delta T max. Now delta T max, so what is the maximum possible temperature difference in a heat exchanger? It is always TH1 minus TC1. Okay, if it is a hot fluid, its temperature at the inlet is TH1, means at outlet its temperature should be equal to that of inlet temperature, cold fluid. Okay, if it is a cold fluid, when it enters its temperature TC1, when it comes out its temperature should be equal to that of inlet temperature of hot fluid. So this is the maximum possible temperature difference in any heat exchanger. And how to find out C minimum? It is very easy. Find out the value of CH and CC, the minimum among that should be taken as C minimum. Okay, so if CH is less than CC, CH is C minimum and CC is C max. If CC is less than CH, CC is C minimum and CH is Cmax. Okay, that is what the expression. This we already know. Therefore, I can write effectiveness as Q by Qmax. So Q can be written in terms of two expression, in terms of hot fluid or cold fluid. So therefore, it is Ch into Th1 minus Th2 divided by Qmax. Qmax, there is only one value. C minimum into delta T is nothing but Th1 minus Tc1. Similarly, I can write this in terms of Cc into Tc2 minus Tc1 divided by C minimum into this value. Okay, so you can use any of these two formula. You can use the first formula when Ch is C minimum. So therefore, both these term get cancelled. So effectiveness is function of only temperature. Suppose Cc is C minimum, use the second formula. So this will get cancelled. Okay, so that is what is called as effectiveness of a heat exchanger. Now we will find out what is NTU. NTU is nothing but, it is one dimensionless term. Okay, the effectiveness relation of heat exchanger typically involves one dimensionless group. It is called UA by C minimum. It is called as, NTU stands for number of transfer units, and it is given by UA by C minimum. Okay, we will see what is this value. So what is the significance of NTU? It is a measure of heat transfer area, and higher the NTU means larger the size of heat exchanger. Higher the NTU means larger is the size. And finally, capacity ratio. The ratio of C minimum by C max, C minimum by C max is called capacity ratio. Okay, it is generally less than 1, but when both the capacity is equal, it will be equal to 1. For a condenser and boiler, this will be 0. We will see what is that. Okay, yes, now we will derive the effectiveness NTU relation for a parallel flow. So we already know this sketch, we have studied in LMT derivation. Consider a parallel flow heat exchanger. Okay, now consider this temperature distribution curve. Let us take TH1 and TH2 are inlet and outlet temperature of hot fluid. TC1 and TC2 are inlet and outlet temperature of cold fluid. Okay, now let us take delta T1 is the temperature difference at inlet, TH1 minus TC1. I will write it as theta1. TH2 minus TC2, that is a temperature difference at outlet. I will write it as theta2. Now consider one small portion of heat exchanger dA. Okay, let us take dTH is the temperature drop in this dA, dTC is the temperature rise in this dA. Okay, now let dQ be the heat transfer between hot and cold fluid. Now let us take TH is the inlet temperature in this small area, and TC is the inlet temperature of cold fluid. So therefore, theta is the difference of TH and TC. Okay. Now let us do this derivation. We have already done this in LMTD part. Similarly, same way. So dQ is UdA into TH minus TC. That is nothing but theta. dQ I can write it as minus MCCPH into dTH. Okay. That is also equal to MCCPC into dTC. Okay. MCCPC and MHCPH I can write it as CH and CC. So therefore dQ is minus CH into dTH, that is equal to here plus CC into dTC. This negative sign is due to negative slope. Okay, this has a positive slope. So therefore I can write dTH and dTC in terms of dQ. Now, so I can write dTH minus dTC is d of TH minus TC. This is nothing but d theta. So d theta is equal to minus dq. Please see there is a difference. D theta is minus dq into 1 by ch plus 1 plus cc. Okay. Now this d theta, you know, dq we have already known. Dq is nothing but uda theta. So therefore I will substitute equation 1 here. Okay. And I will take theta this side. So d theta by theta is equal to minus uda 1 by ch plus 1 by cc. Yes. Now, so here, now we have to integrate that equation from 1 to 2. At inlet area is 0, at outlet area is A. At inlet temperature difference is theta 1, at outlet temperature difference is theta 2, that is TH1 minus TC1, TH2 minus TC2. Okay, so therefore I will get this. So the ln of theta 2 by theta 1, that is minus UA, same thing, dA become, integration of dA is A. I will substitute for theta 2 and theta 1. I will get TH2 minus TC2 by TH1 minus TC1. So here I will take CH outside. Okay, so that I will get minus UA by CH into 1 plus CH by CC. Okay, now here what we will do, let us assume let us take CH as C minimum and CC is C max. So wherever CH is there, C minimum will come. CH is C minimum, CC is C max. Okay. So therefore, now I will take this LAN term to right hand side. So therefore, I will get TH2 minus TC2 divided by TH1 minus TC1 is equal to exponential minus UA by C minimum into 1 plus C minimum by C max. This is nothing but NTU and C. So therefore, this value can be written as e power minus NTU into 1 plus C. Okay. Now, let us solve this further. Okay. So just see here. Now, we already know what is effectiveness means. Okay. Now, effectiveness is given by this expression. You can write in terms of CH or CC. Now, what I should do is, I should replace TH2 here in this expression. TH2 and TC2, I should write in terms of TH1 and TC1 so that this term get cancelled. Okay. Therefore, you take this. So, from this, I can write TH1 minus TH2 is effectiveness into C minimum by CH into this. So therefore, I can write TH2 is equal to TH1 minus effectiveness into C minimum by CH. Since we have assumed C minimum is equal to CH, this will get cancelled. So therefore, TH2 is TH1 minus effectiveness into TH1 minus TC1. Similarly, if I use second formula, I can write TC2, the expression for TC2. Okay, so I can write TC2 minus TC1 is equal to effective net into C minimum by CC into this one. Okay, here CC is nothing but C max. Therefore, I can write TC2 is equal to TC1 plus effective net C minimum by C max. So, C minimum by C max is nothing but C. So, therefore, TC2 is nothing but TC1 plus effectiveness into C into TH1 minus TC1. Okay, see, now I have taken this expression as 2. In this second equation, substitute the value of TH2 and TC2. So if I substitute the value, here it is there. TH2 is obtained by this TH1 minus epsilon into this minus TC2, we already know this, TC1 plus epsilon into this. Okay. So here I can write this in terms of TH1 minus TC1. Take it out. So this TH1 minus TC1 get cancelled. So what is remaining is only 1 by epsilon into 1 plus C. Okay. So therefore, I can write, I will separate now effectiveness. I will take this exponential term to the LHS. So 1 minus e power minus NT into 1 plus C is equal to epsilon into 1 plus C. Therefore, effectiveness for a parallel flow heat exchanger is given by 1 minus e power minus NT into 1 plus C divided by 1 plus C. So this is the expression for effectiveness NT for a parallel flow heat exchanger. Okay. We will do similar derivation for a counter flow. Entire step is same. Okay, only there is a change in sign. So we will see what is that. Okay. So consider the counter flow heat exchanger. Here the direction is opposite. Now the graph, just see the temperature distribution. TH1 and TH2, this is the temperature drop. Here counter flow, cold fluid enters in opposite direction. So TC1 here, when it comes out, TC2. Theta1 is the temperature difference at the inlet, that is TH1 minus TC2. Okay. Theta2 is the temperature difference at outlet, that is TH2 minus TC1. Again, same thing, consider one small area dA. Let us take dTH is the temperature drop, dTC is the temperature rise of the cold fluid. Okay. Theta is the temperature difference at the inlet, that is TH minus TC. Now, all these methods are same. dQ is equal to UdA into this, that you will get theta. But here, as we already studied, the negative sign, both hot and cold fluid will have a negative sign. That is, this is minus, this is also minus. That is because of the negative slope along the this direction, x direction. Okay. So therefore, dTH and dTC can be written as minus dQ by CH minus dQ by CC. So now I will write dTH minus dTC, d of TH minus TC, this is d theta, that is equal to minus dq. Take minus dq outside, you will get 1 by ch minus of 1 by cc. This is the difference. In parallel we have parallel flow, we have plus, here we have minus. Okay. Yeah. So therefore, now my equation becomes d theta is equal to minus dq is nothing but uda theta. So substitute here uda theta, 1 by ch plus this. Take theta to the LHS, d theta by theta. this term you will get. Integrate from theta 1 to theta 2, 0 to a, ln of theta 2 by theta 1 minus ua you will get. Now theta 2 value you substitute here. Theta 2 is nothing but th2 minus tc1, and theta 1 is nothing but th1 minus th2. Okay, substitute here. Ua, take ch outside, you will get this. Now again assume ch is equal to c minimum, cc is equal to c max. Okay, so you will get th2 minus tc1 by th1 minus tc2 equal to e power minus this value. This is nothing but ntu and this is nothing but c. Now again same thing, I should replace th2 and tc2 in terms of th1 and tc1. That is what we will see here. Okay, so using effectiveness equation, I know ch into th1 minus th2 divided by c minimum into th1 minus tc1. So this you know, write th2 and tc2 in terms of th1 and tc1. So I will get th2 expression like this, similar to parallel flow, same way tc2 I will get like this. Substitute both th2 and tc2 in equation 1. So here I have th2 minus tc1. Th2 I write from here, th1 minus epsilon into this minus this, divided by th1 minus tc2. Tc2 this value I will write here. Okay, so if I write here, I take th1 minus tc1 outside, so I will get 1 minus epsilon divided by 1 minus epsilon into c. Okay, now you rearrange all these terms and finally what you will get, epsilon is equal to, so take 1 minus epsilon here, take 1 minus epsilon into c into right hand side, rewrite this. So finally the effectiveness is given by 1 minus e power minus nt into 1 minus c divided by 1 minus c into this. So this is the expression for counter flow heat exchanger. Okay, so we have obtained effectiveness ntu value for both parallel and counter flow. Okay, so you need not by heart all this relation, it is available in the data handbook, just you should know the steps of derivation. Okay, so we have now there is one special case, that is what happens when the capacity ratio becomes zero. So for boiler or condenser, the capacity ratio C becomes zero. That is because for a boiler or condenser, it is losing its latent heat. Okay, so the maximum capacity rate is always tends to infinity. Okay, tends to infinity. So if C max is infinity, C becomes zero. So substitute C is equal to 0 in both expression, you will get effectiveness as 1 minus e power minus NTU. So it is same for parallel or counter. Second special case is this. Okay, when C is equal to 1, what happens? This is possible in some cases like gas turbine generator. Okay, when C is equal to 1, if you put C is equal to 1 in parallel flow equation, you will get this minus 2 NTU by 2. But for a counter flow equation, if you put C is equal to 1, it becomes 0 by 0 form. Okay, then we have to apply L'Hospital's rule that we have studied in CET, right? L'Hospital rule, differentiate numerator and denominator with C and take limit to 1. So the expression becomes effectiveness for a counter flow when C is equal to 1 is NTU by 1 plus NTU. Again, this is available in data handbook. And finally, for multi-pass shell and tube and cross-flow heat exchanger, the effectiveness NTU relation is available in the data handbook. Okay, yes. So with this, we have come to the end of this. So the final conclusion. So LMTD method is mainly used to find out the size of the heat exchanger, and effectiveness NTU method is used whenever the outlet temperature and heat transfer rate is not known. So advantages, you can find out how effective a heat exchanger is for a given size. Okay, and effectiveness we have seen is the ratio of actual to maximum heat transfer rate. NTU refers to size of heat exchanger. And finally, we derived effectiveness NTU for both parallel and counter flow. So effectiveness for a parallel is given by this expression here, you will get plus, counter you will get minus. Okay, so this is the final expression what we got, right? Okay, so thank you very much for your patient listening. We will see you in the next class.